What is up, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome back to the channel. Today's video is mostly about how to get easier lobbies in Warzone. And it's not particularly only Warzone, but it's mostly Warzone. There's a small aspect where this kind of, this information, this knowledge will transfer over slightly over to multiplayer, but it's not exact. Seeing as how there's no easy way to collect data on, you know, people's multiplayer stats game in, game out, unless you want to do, you know, no life it, but unless you want to do that, this video is particularly for Warzone. And so basically there was this Reddit article that led to a link, which is a pretty in-depth study. Like it's a very, you know, there's testing, there's a lot of stuff, and the YouTuber JGuy did cover it. So, you know, partial credit to him, he did cover this first, but most of the credit goes to the guy who actually wrote this article. I don't know if the Reddit user is the same person or not, but I'm going to leave a link to the article itself, you know, just in case. But yeah, this was posted on the Warzone Reddit as well. So if you want to go find it there, you can do that as well. But I highly suggest you read through this article because it's very in-depth. Okay, there's a lot of nuances. There's a lot of strategic, you know, numbers, number placement, just like, okay, if he has this KD, then that means the lobby is going to be like this. Like there's a lot of that in this video. So it's going to be numbers based, going to be kind of analytical. I'm going to try to not like dumb it down, but try to like simplify it as much as possible. So it's easy to digest, easy to understand. And hopefully, you know, there's at least a few tips and tricks in here on how to get easier lobbies in Warzone. So if you're interested in that, there's timestamps in the description and, you know, should be on the video too. So if you want to skip around, you don't care about the numbers or whatever, just skip around in the video and, you know, we'll see where we go. Before we jump right into it, if this is your first time on this channel, just leave a like on the video, subscribe if you're new. All that stuff helps me out. And with all that being said, let's get into the data. For people who are brand new, because I realize there might be some people who are just brand new to, you know, the Call of Duty realm on YouTube, skill-based matchmaking is basically where matchmaking will base you on skill. It'll base you where your Warzone lobbies will be predominantly people of your same skill level. So if you're like a 1-5 KD, the expectation is that people will generally be around that KD, that skill level. Maybe they know how to drop shot, they know how to jump shot, they can play behind cover, they know how much a UAV costs on the back of their hand. You know, you're not going to find people who just downloaded Warzone 20 minutes ago. You're not going to find those people, okay? That's kind of the overall goal of skill-based matchmaking, is to separate people who, you know, play this game day in and day out versus people who jump on once a month, okay? It's to separate them so that, you know, people who jump on once a month don't feel like, oh, I just got murdered 5 games in a row, I'm just going to quit this franchise forever. Like, that's not the point, right? The point is to keep everyone, you know, kind of the same, like, oh, I'm playing a casual too, like, oh, I can get a few kills, and then, you know, eventually you'll be like, okay, like, I can do pretty well in this game. So the point is to get you to keep playing, which is actually what I'm going to talk about later in the video, but it's called engagement optimized matchmaking, or EOMM. And like I said, I'll talk about that later. Now, as far as like strict skill-based matchmaking and like actual statistics on matches and stuff like that, there's only hand testing, right? Because Activision, Modern Warfare, whoever, Raven Software, nobody has released actual like, this is how strict it is, this is how strict it not is, whatever. Like nobody has released any actual data, so we have to go based on what people have reported, what people are kind of announcing to the public, like in articles like these and, you know, Twitter clips, Reddit clips, all that kind of stuff, YouTube videos even. Like I know Exclusive Ace, Drifter, JGod, they did multiple skill-based matchmaking tests on I think multiplayer and maybe Warzone a few months back, so go check those out if you want like more. But like I said, nobody from Activision has, you know, confirmed anything to the degree of it. They haven't even confirmed, you know, if it's really in Warzone or not. We kind of know it is based on playtime and, you know, how we play, but, you know, that's again not confirmed. So now getting more into the article, there's a few key takeaways from this article that I'm going to post on screen and just kind of give my thoughts on. The first one is that player KD has a positive and highly statistical significant impact on lobby strength. For some people, this is common sense and they could have guessed this. For other people, they needed this told to them, because the thing about KD is, KD is a main indicator of a person's skill level, right? When you go in lobbies, people ask, oh, you think you're good? Like, what's your KD? You know, I'm probably higher than you. It's an easy little number to determine, like, oh, he's this good or he's this bad, right? Up until this point, there was no proven knowledge, although people really speculated on, it was KD, maybe it was score per minute, maybe it was headshot percentage or something like that, accuracy. There was no clear way to determine what is, you know, matchmaking you when it comes to skill with other people. And according to this key takeaway from, you know, loads of testing, Player KD, again, has a positive and highly statistical significant impact on the lobby strength. So, you know, if you're playing with a bunch of 3 KD players and you yourself are also a 3 KD player, there's a high chance you're not going to run into a guy with a 0.6 KD. There's just, it's not going to add up that way, okay? Because they want to keep you in that upper echelon of like, oh, hey, this guy's a sweat or pretty much close to a sweat. Let's put him with other people who are of that degree. The article goes on to say, unfortunately, it's not possible to identify which player stat has the strongest impact on skill-based matchmaking, since the skill stats of a player are highly correlated with each other. So KD and score per minute are pretty correlated, right? If you have a high KD, you probably have a high score per minute. And it's of course not completely the same. I'm sure there are some people who go, I don't know, 20-3 every game, but you know, maybe their games are like an hour long. So they really saw like what, 20 interactions in an hour or something like that. Like, that's not the kind of player they're probably focusing on, most likely. They're probably thinking about the player who goes like 30-10 every game or something like that, moving around, jump shotting, drop shotting, all that kind of stuff. That's most likely the player they're identifying, and that's the KD, the score per minute along with that. You know, maybe they play objective, maybe they get kill confirmed tags, domination flags, whatever have you. There was a test done in this article. So they said, like, let's say we pair a 0.3 KD with a 1.7 KD. So the average is a 1 KD, right? Will their lobby strength correspond to the skill bracket of a 0.3, a 1.7, or a 1? And again, this was just done by, you know, I think one or two people, maybe, I don't even know how many people, but it was, you know, one person's testing. Maybe they were off, maybe they just got lucky. So it's not gospel, it's not like fact. But key takeaway number two here is that when players with different skill levels team up, their average squad KD has no direct influence on lobby strength. Meaning that if you have, you know, your 0.3 and your 1.7, are you going to get a 1 KD lobby every time? No. Sometimes you're going to get a 0.6. Sometimes you're going to get a 1.5. You know, it'll hover between that range most likely, but it doesn't mean you're always going to get a 1 KD. There was loads of testing. If you click the link in the article, there's, you know, a chart that says the median lobby KD, and it ranges. It's all over from 0.5 all the way up to 1.3. It doesn't seem to go much higher than 1.3 actually, so maybe I take the 1.5 back. Just because you have a 0.3 KD and a 1.7 KD, again, it doesn't mean you're going to get an average of a 1 KD lobby in Warzone every time. Maybe you will, but it's not going to be every time. So that's interesting to note, especially for me, because whenever I play Warzone, I always assume, like, you know, if I'm a 1.2 or something and my friend's like a 0.6, we should be getting maybe a 0.9, a 0.7, something like that. And I think for the most part, you probably will, especially if you only play like 3-4 games a night or something, you're probably going to end up somewhere in that average. So you're probably going to think like, okay, that's how the matchmaking works. But if you played, I don't know, maybe 30 games, 45 games, something like that, you're probably going to notice like, hey, why are we seeing 1-2 KDs? Why are we seeing 0.2 KD? You know, you're probably going to notice a wider range. So then, what is the effect of teaming up with a relatively lower skilled player? So there's another figure here where the KDs of, where a duo team of KDs of 2.65 and 0.93, which average out to a 1.79 KD, they actually fell pretty close to the previous observation, meaning, you know, you're still within that range of a 0.9 to a 1.2 KD. So even though you have, you know, a 2.65 and a 0.93, your barriers are still, you know, close to that 0.9, 1.3 average, even though you have a guy who's way better, obviously, at a 2.65 KD. In short, this means that two players with a KD of 1.7 will on average play in harder lobbies than a squad containing a 0.3 and a 3.1 KD player. That is a big takeaway. So even though both squads have an average KD of 1.7, your lobby variance is going to be bigger, which means that you're most likely going to have an easier time if you have a guy with a 0.3 KD, even though some other guy has a 3.1 KD. It's very interesting to note there. I think that's interesting. And just to sum that point up, the key takeaway number three here is that the individual skill levels of the players inside a squad determine the bounds of lobby strength in which most matches will occur. In layman's term, this basically means if you have a 1.7 KD and a 1 KD player, you know, playing together, it means that your skill level is going to be somewhere in that bracket. So probably maybe like a 1.1 to a 1.4. That's most likely going to be your range. If I'm just guessing, right? Like a 1.1 to 1.4 average would be your average if you have those two guys playing together. You're not going to run into any 2 KD lobbies if the highest guy has a 1.7 KD. That's kind of the general takeaway. So don't worry about that. You know, if your whole squad here or something is like a, I don't know, a 1 KD, you're not going to run into a 1.7, a 1.8 average. Okay, that's, you can relax on that. The rest of the article talks about engagement optimized matchmaking. You can kind of read that about yourself. It's pretty interesting, honestly. And there's actually a few takeaways regarding that. I'm not going to go into all of them super in detail, but the main takeaway regarding EOMM is that skill-based matchmaking is at its strictest from 8 p.m. to 2 a.m. and gets toned down massively from 3 a.m. to 7 a.m. all local time. This is very, very interesting because it means they want to keep you on this game as long as possible during waking hours. Think about it. Who's playing Call of Duty from 3 to 7, right? Like, not many people. 3 a.m. to 7 a.m., most normal people, you know, go to school, have jobs, stuff like that. They're most likely asleep, or maybe they're on the night shift. Maybe they're working at that time. Not many people are playing games at that time. I know there are some people, but I'm just saying not many. Because of that, it makes the most sense for skill-based matchmaking to be at its strictest from 8 to 2 a.m. because these are the hours that most people game, right? Most people come back from a day of school, day of work, something like that. They want to sit down and game. And in order to keep them on the game longer, you've got to give them skill-based matchmaking, right? Skill-based matchmaking, in theory, is designed to get people to keep playing, right? Like, you almost won, maybe you'll get an easier lobby here. You can have a slightly easier lobby, and then you'll do better here, and maybe you'll stay on if you win, or if you get close enough to win. I think this is the biggest takeaway. If you want to get easier lobbies, play Warzone at 3 or 4 a.m. I think that's hilarious. There's also a chart there. I'm not going to show it or whatever. Just click the link in the article. But I think that's actually hilarious. Again, it's engagement optimized matchmaking. They used, elite players matches or something like that during skill-based matchmaking prime time to determine basically how sweaty a certain lobby is. And we found out it's affected by a player's recent performance. And so the next question is, does recent performance matter? And apparently, according to this article, there's no evidence that recent player performance has a significant impact on lobby strength when computing performance based on average kills, KDs, death, score per minute, damage per minute, score per minute, lifetime, all that kind of stuff. Being on a losing streak has no impact on lobby strength. Now, I'm going to say no impact, but like very little impact strength. Honestly, there's so much more in this article. I could make a part 2. I could probably make a part 3 just reading this article. I actually trimmed down so much, even though this video is probably getting kind of long at this point. In conclusion, I just want to summarize here, and then I'll give you some quick tips at the very end here. The matchmaking of Warzone is heavily influenced by player stats related to skill. So there's no conclusive evidence for, engagement optimized matchmaking. Although the whole like 8 p.m. to 2 a.m. time then with heightened skill-based matchmaking, that's kind of suggestive of like, yeah, there's probably something going on here, especially if they can like validate that. Still, these results are definitely useful, and they definitely tell you a lot about the game that, Activision and Modern Warfare probably didn't want you to know. So it may be well that maybe, your best Warzone content creators, maybe they're playing during times of low skill-based matchmaking. Maybe they're playing with a friend who has like a 0.4 KD or something, or maybe like a 1 KD, I don't know, and something like that. And maybe they're just getting easier lobbies that way. Whatever the case may be, I hope that this kind of helped you out. I hope those last two tips kind of gave you some insight as far as like, oh, like maybe I can play during the night, or maybe I can party up with someone who's really, really bad to make my lobbies, easier or something like that. With that being said, there's still the concept of reverse boosting. There's still the concept of session joining. So, keep in mind when, someone drops, 100 kills in Warzone as a team, maybe something was up there. I'm just saying maybe. I'm not saying anybody in particular or anything, but maybe something happened there to kind of help them along there. But anyway, that's it for the video. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you learned something about skill-based matchmaking, engagement optimized matchmaking. I thought this was a very, very interesting read. I do recommend giving it a skim. Most of this video was pretty much not read off of this, but very based off of this. So full credit goes to this article. All the authors, they're all in the description. They're all in the bottom of the page. So go check them out. Maybe go give them a follow on Reddit or something like that. I don't know how Reddit works. And if you enjoyed the video, leave a like on the video, subscribe if you're new, turn on the notification bell, and I will see you in the next video. Thanks so much for watching up to this point. If you did, comment oranges, why not? And I'll see you in the next one. Peace out.